Well, welcome everyone. We have made it to Friday of Will's Week, day five. And today we have with us Lee Carpenter to talk about LGBTQ estate planning. And before I introduce Lee, I just want to remind you of a couple of housekeeping items. Please put your questions in the Q&A and the running comments over in the chat. We can't move things over to Q&A. And as a matter of fact, Lee said that his program is pretty packed today, so he will get to as many questions as he can at the end. But so that's all the more reason to get them over in the chat. I mean, in the Q&A where we'll be able to see them. So again, I'm Ann Kolakowski, Director of Gift Planning Services for the University System of Maryland. And I'm really delighted to welcome everyone today. I hope that whether this is your first session or your fifth, that you've been learning really useful advice and tips on how to put your own plans in place. Just a reminder that we're recording today's session, and we will be sending both links to all of the recordings. So if you didn't have a chance to watch earlier in the week, go back and check them out because there's great content there. And we will be sending a survey, and it really, really helps us plan for next year and other programs that we host here at the system. So please do take a few minutes and fill that out. So today, as I mentioned, I'm delighted to introduce Lee Carpenter, who's a principal in the Estates and Trust Practice Group at Offutt Kerman. He's an accredited estate planner with extensive experience with estate planning and probate work, trust administration, general business, and corporate law. He strives to create a welcoming environment where clients of all backgrounds feel comfortable discussing their legal needs. His practice includes a special emphasis on the unique needs of same-sex couples and other members of the LGBTQ community. As an active member of the community himself, he has testified before the Maryland General Assembly in favor of pro-LGBTQ legislation, and he's a board member at Free State Justice, a nonprofit that advocates on behalf of LGBTQ Marylanders. He's a graduate of the University of Maryland School of Law, where he teaches estates and trusts as an adjunct professor. He also chairs the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra's Planned Giving Advisory Council, and he's a frequent author and lecturer on the topic that we're about to hear him address now. So without further ado, thank you so much and welcome, Lee.
All right, thanks very much, Anne. Hello, everyone. It's nice to see a few familiar faces today. I appreciate your interest in this topic. I'd also like to thank the University of Maryland, my two-time alma mater, for the invitation to close out this series of presentations for Estate Planning Awareness Week. As Anne said, my name is Lee Carpenter, and I'm a partner in the Estates and Trust Department at Offutt Kerman. My office is up in Timonium, Maryland, and I'm very happy to have the opportunity to talk to you today about the special estate planning needs of same-sex couples and other members of the LGBTQ community. So just one word of caution, if you hear anything that you think might be helpful to you, please speak with a lawyer before taking any action on the information I'm providing. Just make sure we get it right. So Offutt Kerman is one of very few law firms with attorneys who are from the LGBTQ community themselves and who work in a practice group dedicated to serving the needs of this community. So about half of my clients are LGBTQ folks, and I've learned about the special concerns and conventions that can apply when working with this demographic. So about 30 years ago, my step-grandfather died. And his estate was very complicated and very contentious. And it took about 6 years for us to close that estate. And my family, so this was my step-grandfather, so my biological family was represented by an attorney who was kind of like the family doctor. And he knew everyone in the family and who the capable people were and who maybe the greedy people were. And he was very reassuring in getting us through that process. So at the end, when the estate was settled, I knew that I wanted to provide that same kind of help to other people. And that's how I got into estates and trusts. Now, I can say that in my almost 20 years of practice, I've never had an estate that was quite that complicated. And that's something I'm grateful for. But that's how I got my start. So what I'd like to do is spend the first half of our time today talking a little about the LGBT community and what makes it unique. And in the second half, then we'll get into the nuts and bolts of LGBTQ estate planning in particular and the special considerations that often apply. So first, what do we mean by LGBTQ? So this is an initialism that stands for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer or questioning. It used to be gay, lesbian, but women didn't like coming second all the time, so they switched it around. So now it's lesbian, gay, bisexual. That's fine. That's fine. As I'm sure you know, the word lesbian refers to women who are attracted to other women. Gay refers to men who are attracted to men, but it can also be used more broadly to refer to men and women who are attracted to people of the same sex. So the term the gay community is usually taken to include the LGBTQ community as a whole. One word to avoid using is homosexual, which now usually just appears in a scientific context, as in homosexual behavior in the animal kingdom. Bisexual refers to someone who is attracted to people of either sex. The T is for transgender. Someone who is transgender was born with the physical characteristics of one gender, but identifies as the opposite gender. And we'll talk more about this in just a few minutes. The Q stands for questioning, which could apply maybe to a young person who isn't sure about their sexual orientation. It can also stand for queer, which was originally, as I'm sure you know, a term of disparagement, but it has been reclaimed by some members of the community who call themselves queer as a point of pride. It's not unlike the pink triangle that gay people were forced to wear in labor camps during the Second World War. The pink triangle has also been reclaimed as a symbol now of affirmation. Now, this LGBTQ thing can be a little unwieldy. There's talk about just using the word queer to refer to the entire community. We're not quite there yet, but you may hear individuals referring to the queer community, and really they mean the LGBTQ community, the gay community. Those are all pretty much synonymous. Now, there is sometimes an I at the end, which stands for intersex. Intersex people are born with physical sex characteristics that don't fit the typical binary notions of male or female. So intersex is an umbrella term that can describe a wide range of natural bodily variations. In some cases, intersex traits are visible at birth. In other cases, they are not apparent until puberty. And in some cases, they're not physically apparent at all. For example, an intersex person could have a chromosome variation that doesn't fit the typical XXY or XY female. Or their sexual anatomy might not be clearly male or female, but it could be indeterminate. Someone may be identified as intersex at birth, but more often the person is raised as either a man or a woman, usually at the direction of their parents. Intersex individuals have been known to be subjected to involuntary surgery or hormonal treatment to try to fit them into one gender category or the other. But the more enlightened trend now is to allow intersex individuals to self-identify in a way that reflects their sense of their gender. Now, intersex people used to be called hermaphrodites, a term you may have heard, but that term has fallen out of favor. So now it's considered to be misleading and a bit stigmatizing. So that's a word we want to avoid. Now, at the end, you may also see an A, which can stand for ally. So someone who is not otherwise LGBTQ, but supports this community. And I hope we have a lot of allies among us today. It can also stand for asexual, which names someone who may be attracted to others or may not be, but if they are, they don't express that attraction in a sexual manner. So to avoid complete alphabet soup, this is sometimes shortened to LGBTQ+. Now, there are a few other terms I'd like you to be aware of. One is gender nonconforming, which refers to people who don't follow other people's ideas or stereotypes of how they should look or act based on the sex they were assigned at birth. Prince, the pop singer who died back in 2016, is a good example. Was Prince gay or bisexual? Hard to say, but we do know that he was certainly gender nonconforming. It's a very broad term. Non-binary refers to a person who doesn't subscribe to conventional gender distinctions and identifies with neither male nor female genders, or maybe both of them, or perhaps a combination of the two. The terms gender fluid and gender queer are also used in the same context. So someone who is non-binary, gender queer, or gender fluid could move along a continuum between masculinity and femininity, and they might use pronouns other than he or she, such as they. This is a picture of Oslo Grace, who's a very successful non-binary model and uses they-them pronouns. And in fact, the dictionary now lists the word they as a singular pronoun. And for any fellow grammarians who are on the call, it still uses a plural verb. So if a non-binary person walked to the room using they-them pronouns, we'd say there they are, not there they is. Now, it's possible people may use other pronouns that they prefer. I hope this is readable, but There are pronouns like z, zir, zim. Some people might use the honorific mx period instead of Mr. or Ms. It's pronounced mix. And we have a list here of other pronouns that are sometimes seen. In my experience, it's unusual for most of these pronouns to be used. Most people either use he, she, or they. But you should be aware that you may come across this in dealing with people from the LGBTQ community. Now, the term cisgender means having a gender identity that matches the sex the person was assigned at birth. So cisgender has its origin in a Latin prefix, cis, which means on this side of, means the opposite of trans or across from, or on the other side of. So cisgender is really the opposite of transgender. And so most of the population is cisgender. So that's LGBTQ and a few other things besides. So one thing I'd like to point out, this is often confused, is that there's a difference between sexual orientation and gender identity. Sexual orientation refers to who you are attracted to, whether you are heterosexual, gay, lesbian, bisexual, or perhaps pansexual. Gender identity refers to how you identify, whether as male, female, non-binary, cisgender, transgender, that sort of thing. So it's possible for someone to be, for example, gay and non-binary, to be bisexual and male, to be, you could mix and match these two columns. They are not the same thing. All right. Now, I don't know if any of you read The Onion. It's a favorite newspaper of mine. I've been reading it long enough that it used to be in print. Now it's just online, but it's a satirical newspaper that has some funny headlines. And years ago, they had one that said, "Stereotypes are a real time saver." So we are not trafficking in stereotypes today, but we are talking in very broad generalizations, and I want to make that clear. Every couple, every person is obviously unique, but my experience has shown in working with the LGBTQ community that it often involves several specific considerations. The first is a need for comfort in working with new people, especially in a professional context. The second is that there are important generational differences that we should be aware of, and there are some ongoing challenges in the form of discrimination and anti-LGBTQ legislation that I'd like to talk about. So first, the need for comfort. So there's often a greater need for comfort in dealing with new people, especially, as I said, in a professional context. If an LGBTQ couple or individual are going to work with a lawyer, it's obviously important that they feel comfortable doing so. They need to feel welcome coming to the office. They need to feel like their confidences will be respected. All it takes, and I can tell many stories, all it takes is one look of disapproval for the couple or the person to decide that this is not the lawyer for us, or this is not the accountant for us, or the bank teller, or whatever the case might be. So if you are looking for an attorney to help with LGBTQ estate planning, finding an attorney who is either in the community or supports the community, is a good place to start. So as a member of the LGBTQ community myself, I have many clients who travel long distances to come see me because they want to work with someone who understands their needs on a personal level. So in working with LGBTQ folks, it's important that the attorney uses the right terms when referring to people. Now, I don't know if anyone has ever called you by the wrong name, even if it was unintentional, but this can be a very personal kind of affront. There was a period where, for some reason, people were calling me Les instead of Lee. I don't know what it was, but I wanted to say, I don't know who Les is, but that is not me. In working with LGBTQ individuals, using preferred names is obviously a good way to start. And you should bear in mind that that may not be the name the person was given by their parents. So on my intake sheet for new clients, I have blanks after the words, "Please call me, my pronouns are," so that I can be sure that I use the right terms. Now, for
Hey everyone. Oh, there he's coming back. Yay.
Okay.
We didn't lose you for good. Okay. All right. Jump on back in.
My apologies. I don't know what happened, but I somehow was no longer on the call. Let me reshare my screen. Okay, so I hope you're able to see that now. We're back in business. I apologize. I'm not sure what happened there.
We're
But
not
anyway.
seeing your we're not seeing your slides yet.
Okay. I wonder.
Do you want to try and email it to me or as PDF while you're trying to do that? Or
I can do that.
any Zoom pros out there have any better suggestions? Throw them in the chat.
I can't get the Zoom window to open up. I can email them to you if you'd like to do that.
Sure.
Okay.
Leave and come back is the first thing Sarah Shannon tries. So I think actually we did that by accident. So I don't think he intended to leave and come back, but
Okay, we'll get this figured out in just a second
yep.
here.
Yeah,
Appreciate everyone's
maybe
patience.
sure. And I don't know if there's anything not so graphic heavy, maybe you could just sort of keep let's see. All right.
Okay, so I just sent you the slides. So we're on slide 19. So Anne, you're able to share your screen instead of having me share mine?
I should be able to. Let's
Okay.
see.
So while she's working on that, I was talking about same-sex couples and how it's important to ask what terms they use in referring to each other. So some couples may feel strongly about calling each other their partner or their spouse or husband, wife, roommate. Sometimes we'll hear companion or friend, and they could take offense at any other term. So some lesbian couples I know, for example, think the term wife suggests subjugation and subservience. But others feel like they worked hard to earn the right to stop using the word partner and to call each other their wife. So on the flip side, I've come across at least one married straight couple who insisted on using the word partner to refer to each other because they thought the terms husband and wife were too loaded with cultural baggage. So it's important to follow the couple's lead in how they refer to each other. So I am married. My husband and I have a son who's 8 years old. And a few years ago, on his first day of school, when I was dropping him off, the teacher said, "What does he call the two of you?" And I said, "Well, my husband is daddy and I'm papa." And the teacher said, "Perfect, got it." And from then on, they were very good at saying, "Okay, say goodbye to papa," or "daddy's here to pick you up." And that kind of sensitivity in orienting yourself toward the other person and the terms that they use goes a long way to establishing a very positive relationship, whether this is in a social context or a professional one.
Lee, I'm sorry to interrupt. I haven't gotten your email yet. I don't know if the
Oh, sorry.
gremlins are messing with us today.
Okay. Well, I do see the
Do you want
share
to try it
button
again?
again.
Yeah,
Yeah, let
try it
me try
again.
it
I
again.
didn't.
Okay. So, okay. Just 1 second. Okay. All right.
Perfect. We're back
Are we
in
back in
business.
business?
We're back in
Okay.
business. Thank you, everyone, for your patience, and thank you for your persistence, Lee.
Yes, thank you for your patience. This is going to be, oh yeah, there was that one presentation where everything went haywire. Unfortunately, that's how this one is going to be remembered, but there we go. Okay, so let's move on to we were talking about terms that we use in referring to members of this community. So I asked if anyone's ever called you by the wrong name. Another question is, anyone ever called you by the wrong gender? So as a teenager, this sometimes happened to me when I was talking to someone on the phone. My voice hadn't settled in yet, and having someone call me ma'am was especially dispiriting. But members of the trans and the gender non-conforming community are used to having this happen all the time. But it's easy to avoid mistakes like this with a little guidance. So first, let me just explain that being transgender is not a matter of choice so much as a manifestation of an innate identity. So a transgender person may go through a period of transition, usually does, which could involve changing their name, hormone therapy, surgery, as well as changes in how they dress and style themselves. The process is usually gradual. It doesn't need to include any specific steps in any particular order. So, for example, someone transitioning from female to male might begin by changing their name and the way they dress. This could include their clothes, their hairstyle, mannerisms, body language, their voices, to better express their gender identity. Then the next step could be to begin hormone replacement therapy. Eventually, they might undergo gender reassignment surgery, which is sometimes called gender confirmation surgery. This can often involve several different procedures, and a transgender man might undergo some of them, or all of them, or none of them. I won't talk about any of these procedures in detail, but I will give one example of voice surgery, which can change the pitch of a person's voice to better match their gender identity. Now, when it comes to transitioning, economics can be a big factor here because health insurance does not usually cover gender confirmation surgery. So some people are limited in what they can do because of their economic situation. Now there are some legal steps that can be taken too, such as changing a person's name and gender marker on their birth certificate and their driver's license. In the context of a couple, one person may have transitioned before the two met, or the transition may occur after they're married. So the key here is to respect how they present themselves, whether as a man or a woman, and honor their gender identity, use the names and pronouns that they prefer. Now, someone who was assigned the sex of female at birth and presents as a man is a transgender man and should probably be referred to as he and him unless they use different pronouns, which is possible. But the best thing to call this person would simply be a man. You can also say the person is trans masc, which is short for transgender masculine. It's interesting, there was a political debate many years ago. I think it was a town hall during which someone asked one of the candidates a question, and the question came from a transgender man. And the candidate responded by saying, "A man likes you understands this better than anyone else." And the candidate was widely praised for recognizing the questioner simply as a man and not necessarily as a transgender man. Chaz Bono, the child of Sonny Bono and Cher, is one example of a trans man. Chaz grew up as Chastity Bono and then transitioned as an adult. So, in the same way, someone who was assigned the sex of male at birth and presents as female is a transgender woman and should be referred to as she and her, unless they use different pronouns, which is possible. The better thing to call this person would simply be a woman. We could also use the term trans femme, which is short for transgender feminine. Now, Laverne Cox is an example many of us are familiar with from Orange is the New Black. Now, when it comes to these terms, members of the trans community are used to people getting this wrong all the time. So if you're unsure of a person's gender, a simple, "How should I address you?" or "What pronouns do you use?" will prevent any awkward guessing. Now, I would like to point out that the word is transgender and not transgendered, which would suggest that something was done to the person rather than referring to an innate identity. And as a kind of shorthand, it's perfectly acceptable to refer to someone as trans or a member of the trans community. It's kind of like that whole thing with alumni, alumnus, alumni. A lot of us can't figure that out, but you could call someone an alum and you're on safe ground there. Now, the word transsexual has fallen out of favor. So the respectful term now is transgender. And I'll point out also, I hate even to say the word, but the word tranny is extremely offensive and it's never appropriate in any context, social or professional. I'd also like to point out that it's impolite to ask about the details of a person's transition unless they volunteer this information. So this would include the name the person used to use, which is called their dead name, unless, you know, in my case, I sometimes need to know that for legal reasons. But in general, we shy away from dead names. What surgeries the person's had, whether they can still have children, things like that, these are inappropriate questions. And it may seem like I don't even need to point this out, but Katie Couric interviewed Laverne Fox years ago and asked about her private parts. She actually used the term private parts, which was wildly inappropriate, and she later apologized for it. So the same rules that would apply on talking to anyone else would apply on talking to a transgender person. Now, there are a few, I think I've always found scripts to be helpful. So if someone discloses to you that they are transgender, there are certain things to avoid saying, such as, when did you decide to be transgender? Can I see a picture of the old you? Your poor parents must have been devastated when you told them. Or it's a shame you were such a pretty girl or such a handsome boy. Most transgender people would like to look to the future rather than discuss details of their past. One of the most gracious remarks I've ever heard was in response to someone at an alumni event who said, you may remember me from college as Jennifer Brown, and now I've come back as, and the other person jumped in and said, and now you've come back as yourself. So I think this exchange demonstrates the best way to be affirming of someone's gender identity. So helping people feel welcome, using the appropriate terms, important to getting things off on the right foot. Now, I mentioned that there are some generational differences, and this isn't really a matter of whether someone is a baby boomer or a millennial. Members of the LGBTQ community had starkly different experiences growing up, and in many cases, they were shaped by these experiences. So the older segment grew up in a time when being gay was stigmatized, and it was considered to be both illegal and immoral. And so people lived lives of great secrecy and fear and discretion, and many of them grew up feeling like outcasts. Being out wasn't really possible, even to their own families. And in some cases, parents might ship their kids off to conversion therapy, which is a kind of boot camp where there were facilitators who would try to change their sexual orientation. If a person sought help from their religion, they might be told that they were living a sinful way of life and would be condemned to eternal torment, or they could be arrested for being intimate with someone of the same sex. And of course, even if they just wanted to take their mind off their troubles and go to a movie, any portrayal they would have seen of gay people on the screen would have been very negative, probably effeminate caricatures or maybe sex workers or vampires, something like that. So in this climate of intolerance, many people feared for their safety and for their jobs, and many of them still do. In about half the states in this country, it's still legal to fire someone just for being gay or transgender. Now, in 2020, the US Supreme Court ruled that the Civil Rights Act protects LGBTQ individuals from being fired because of their sexual orientation or gender identity, but that's just at the federal level. So this is one area where the law has been slow to catch up with changes in society, and there is more work to be done. Now, one consequence of this climate that people grew up in is that gay people tended to go to gay doctors and gay lawyers if they could find a member of their community to go to, because there was a great fear of sharing any kind of legal or medical information with someone outside of their community. Many people still prefer to do this, but they're also likely to feel comfortable going to someone outside the community who has a reputation for being LGBTQ friendly. Now, more recently, of course, members of the community have grown up in an environment of much greater acceptance and inclusivity. And so being gay has kind of entered the mainstream in a lot of cases. People are coming out in high school or even younger, and many schools now have a gay-straight alliance. It's interesting, I went to a very conservative boys' school in Washington, D.C. for part of my education. And there were a few people who were gay there, but no one was out. Absolutely no one is out. And now all these years later, 35 years later, that school has a gay straight alliance, which I think is nothing short of remarkable. So there's hope all around. The Supreme Court's decision in Lawrence v. Texas made it no longer illegal to have intimate relations with someone of the same sex. And then there was the Obergefell decision in 2015, which said that same-sex couples could now get married anywhere in the US. And you can find a church that will actually perform the ceremony. And I'd just like to mention there's an organization called GLAAD, the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation. And because of their efforts and just changing attitudes in general, movie and TV producers are much more sensitive about how they portray LGBTQ individuals. There was a great romantic comedy, or an okay romantic comedy, called Love, Simon that came out a few years ago that had a very positive portrayal of a gay high school student. And more recently, there's a TV show called Heartstopper that is also extremely positive. So one of the benefits of this progress is that it's no longer necessary for people to feel like they have to go to professionals who are members of their community. But some of the members of the older segment, the older generation, are going to have some holdovers, some instincts and predispositions from this experience of having grown up in a period of intolerance. So they're more likely to use the term friend or roommate when talking about their partners. So the important thing to remember is this is all about people simply being themselves. Now, there are a few ongoing challenges for this community that I'd like to talk about. So first with conversion therapy, it was outlawed in Maryland a few years ago. So this is conversion therapy for minors is no longer legal in Maryland, but it is still legal in most of the United States. About 75% of LGBTQ students report being harassed, verbally harassed in the past year because of their sexual orientation. And many of these kids attend a school that has a gay-straight alliance. And then a disproportionate number of homeless people are LGBTQ. Some have been disowned by their families and become susceptible to addiction, sex work, HIV, even suicide. So that's a very sensitive demographic that is certainly in need of whatever assistance we can provide. And then among trans individuals, I read a recent article that talked about an epidemic of violence against transgender people. Trans folks often have problems with housing and employment. There's that recent Supreme Court decision that's helpful. But again, that's just at the federal level, and there's an exception for religious organizations. And so for transgender folks, poverty is often a problem as a result. And to add insult to injury, a recent survey found that most people will actually deliberately use the pronouns corresponding to the person's gender at birth when speaking to a transgender person. And then I'll just point out that we have about 530 anti-LGBTQ bills that are under consideration in state legislatures around the country. And many of these are targeting transgender individuals, but not entirely. It's just LGBTQ targeted legislation really across the spectrum. So there is still some work to be done here. So that's about the community, and I hope you found that helpful. Now I'd like to talk specifically about LGBTQ estate planning. And I hope that previous discussion will kind of inform this part of my talk. But estate planning is sometimes called life and estate planning. And as I'm sure you know, it helps someone prepare for financial and health-related matters to be managed during any period of incapacity and to provide for the efficient transfer of their assets when the person dies. So LGBTQ estate planning is really just good estate planning. My goal today is to touch on some of the unique factors and nuances that can be helpful to know about when putting an estate plan together. So an estate plan generally includes three essential documents. The first is a last will and testament, which does several important things. Obviously, it says who gets what if someone dies, but just as importantly, it says who will settle the person's estate. So we want to make sure we have the right person in charge of the estate. If the person who's died has children, we might want to set up a trust so that the children don't receive their money outright, but would receive it in distributions at certain ages, perhaps. We would name guardians for the children. We would say who the trustees are going to be. We can take care of any pets the person has if they want to disinherit someone. So a will is a very powerful instrument, one of the most important things a person will ever sign. Now, a will obviously applies if someone dies. A financial power of attorney and advanced medical directive apply if the person is still alive but loses capacity. So if you lose the ability to pay your bills or file your taxes, or if it's time to sell your house and move you to Shady Pines, the person you've authorized under a power of attorney can take care of these things for you. So it's a very important document to have. And then an advanced medical directive is like the power of attorney, but it is for medical matters. So if you're under a doctor's care and you can't speak for yourself, then the person you've appointed can interact with your doctors, access your medical records, and say what kind of care you'd like to receive. Now, the second part of an advance directive is the living will part, where you say what kind of care you would like to receive if you're in an end-of-life situation. So this is normally describes a situation where someone is actively dying, there's no hope of recovery, and you can say, keep me comfortable and lay on the pain medication, or ask for more aggressive treatment in those circumstances. Now, I'll just mention that an advance directive is especially important for transgender individuals because it's your opportunity to say what name and pronouns you'd like to have used while you're under medical care. And you can also say that you would like to have your appearance maintained to the extent possible to match your gender identity, something that might go overlooked if it's not spelled out in your advance directive. Now, I'd like to point out that there are other ways that assets transfer other than through your will. One is through a beneficiary designation on an asset like life insurance or retirement account, like a 401k or an IRA. The beneficiary you name on these kinds of assets will receive that asset regardless of what your will says. So this takes precedence over anything in your will. So it's important that we make sure the beneficiaries under your will and the beneficiaries on your life insurance and retirement accounts work together so that we don't have them fighting each other and creating some sort of adverse outcome, which unfortunately I've seen happen many times. Any asset that you own jointly will generally belong to the joint owner if one of you dies, depending on how the asset is titled. This would include things like bank accounts and real estate. And then a revocable living trust is a substitute for a will that can be appropriate in some circumstances. It's a trust that you set up in your lifetime and transfer all your assets into the trusts by retitling your house, retitling your accounts. And then upon your death, the assets in the trust will transfer to your beneficiaries without the need to open up a probate estate. So a revocable living trust will transfer assets outside of your will. Now, for the particular concerns of the LGBTQ community when it comes to estate planning, there is often greater complexity in preparing a plan. There is often an absence of children. We have non-traditional families that we need to work with. Maryland has an inheritance tax, and I will call it the notorious Maryland inheritance tax, that can affect LGBTQ folks disproportionately. There's often hostile family members we need to deal with one way or another. There's the question of whether to get married. And then we now have an alternative to marriage, a domestic partnership registry that I would like to talk about as well. So let's start with complexity. So the first challenge in working with same-sex couples is that the estate plan may involve greater complexity than it would for an opposite-sex couple. So these couples often have less conventional family connections and social circles. There may be strained relationships with family members, and in some cases, there's outright hostility. Family members may disapprove of their relationship, or there could just be simple family dysfunction, which you see in all sorts of families. And as a result, their wills may want to honor relationships beyond that of their partner, spouse, parents, siblings, that kind of thing. So an example here of an opposite sex couple's estate plan: they will typically leave their estate to the surviving spouse if one of them dies, and then to their children in equal shares. So this is my bread and butter. I've drafted plenty of estate plans that did pretty much this. But a same-sex partner might want to leave something like this, with half of his estate going to his partner, half is going into a trust for his mother. And see if you can see my cursor, but half going into a trust for his mother. And then when mom dies, what's left in the trust is distributed to nieces and nephews in different percentages and under different terms, at different ages, immediately in this case, upon graduation from college. Plans like this are really not uncommon. And as a consequence, I generally allow about 50% more time for estate planning meetings with same-sex couples versus straight couples. Another factor we need to take into account is an absence of children. So, and this is part of what fuels the complexity. About 29% of same-sex couples have children, compared to about 70% of heterosexual couples. So an absence of children can call for more creative planning to determine where the couple's assets will go. And as a result, their plans are more likely to include bequests to nieces and nephews, important friends, charitable and philanthropic causes, godchildren, that sort of thing. This can have tax implications for good and for bad, which we'll talk about in just a minute. But as you can see, there are The will that would be created here would have a lot of entries to account for all these family members and charities and whatnot. So a bit more complex than just having it go to the children in equal shares. Now, I mentioned that we often have non-traditional families. When same-sex couples do have children, there may be even greater complexity. We could have children from a prior heterosexual relationship, and the new spouse may or may not have adopted the children by a second parent adoption. The couple could have adopted children together, but in some states, only one partner in a same-sex couple can adopt the child, and then the other parent has to do a second parent adoption, which may or may not happen. A child could have been born by a surrogate mother, in which case there should be a legal contract in place that says that the surrogate and the donor, whether it's an egg donor or a sperm donor, have waived any legal rights to the child. So in estate planning, it's essential that we understand the exact legal relationships between the couple and any children. People like to think of their children as their kids, but from a legal standpoint, it can be more complicated than that. Okay, now I have some good news from an estate planning standpoint, and that is that in Maryland, the legislature recently recognized that many families are non-traditional and that some couples will choose to remain unmarried. And there could be reasons for that. They could consider themselves too young to get married, or perhaps their parents got divorced and they're wary of entering into a marriage, or they're just wary to make a lifelong commitment. But last year, the Maryland legislature came up with a domestic partnership registry, and it exempts the surviving partner from the Maryland inheritance tax, which we'll talk about in a little bit. If the couple has a, if they die without wills, the surviving partner is allowed a $100,000allowance on the death of the first partner, and then a share of the deceased partner's estate. This is if there is no will. It's very easy to register as domestic partners. There's a one-page form that you just submit to the Register of Wills for the county that you live in, and it is inexpensive. It is only $25. So that's some helpful news on the estate planning front. So I mentioned the inheritance tax. This is a 10% tax that applies to a bequest that you leave to someone who's not a spouse, a registered domestic partner, or a close family member. So this would be a partner to whom you are not married or with whom you are not registered, nieces and nephews, and friends. So this tax doesn't apply to any bequest you leave to a parent, to a spouse, to a registered domestic partner, to a child, or to a sibling of yours. If we have an unmarried couple, the tax is going to apply to the entire bequest that they leave to the surviving partner, unless they registered as domestic partners before they died. So that's 10% of the estate coming right off the top if we have an unmarried or unregistered couple. Now, of course, same-sex couples can get married and they can register as domestic partners. So this is very helpful. But whether they are married or not, they often want to leave bequests to their nieces and nephews, and they are considered what we call non-lineal descendants, and therefore the gifts to them are subject to the inheritance tax. Now, it's worth mentioning that this tax is a tax on the recipient of the property. The will can be set up so that the estate will pay the tax, so the recipient gets the full amount of the bequest. But it may be better to avoid the tax altogether by naming the recipient as the beneficiary of a life insurance policy, because under life insurance, the inheritance tax doesn't apply. Or it can be helpful to have life insurance simply to provide some liquidity in the estate to pay off any inheritance taxes that might be due. So some considerations there depending on the circumstances. Now, I mentioned that there can be hostile family members. This comes up quite a bit. And if that's the case, there are some things we can do to try to keep these hostile family members at bay. One is to include an interim provision in the will, which says that if anyone tries to challenge this will, that person is to receive nothing from my estate. Now, the way to put some teeth into this is to actually leave a bequest to the person so that if they do challenge the will, they'll be putting their bequest in jeopardy. But just including this language can be helpful just to emphasize the testator's intent in setting up the will the way they did. Another option is to set up a revocable living trust. So I talked about trusts a couple of minutes ago. I don't usually recommend trusts, but one of the benefits is that they are private. When someone dies and we open up a probate estate, their will becomes a public document. Anyone can go to the Register of Wills website and get a copy for 50 cents a page. But if they have a revocable trust, the trust is private, doesn't go on the website. And so the terms are not known to anyone in the family. And that can be helpful when we have any family hostility. Okay. Let's move on to the question of whether to marry. So I counsel a lot of people on whether or not they should get married. This is one of the most important factors in someone's estate plan is their marital status. And of course, up until recently, this wasn't available to same-sex couples. It's now legal nationwide. You might remember that in 2012, the Maryland legislature passed a bill legalizing same-sex marriage, and then the voters affirmed the bill in a referendum a short time later. Then we had federal recognition of same-sex marriage in the United States versus Windsor decision. That was in 2013. And then in 2015, the Supreme Court ruled in Obergefell versus Hodges that gay and lesbian couples could enter into legal marriages regardless of where they live. So that's Edie Windsor on the left. She and her wife died and had a taxable estate, and Edie successfully sued to be excused from the federal estate tax as a surviving spouse. At the time, her home in New York recognized their marriage, but the federal government did not recognize it. And so Edie pursued the case all the way up to the Supreme Court, and she won. And on the right, we have James Obergefell and his husband, John Arthur. John was critically ill, and they wanted to get married, but they lived in Ohio, where same-sex marriage was not yet legal. And so they flew on a medical transport plane to Maryland. They flew to BWI and they got married on the tarmac in the plane. That's where that picture is from. And a few months later, when John died, James sued to have his name included on the death certificate, and he fought that battle all the way up to the Supreme Court, and he also prevailed. So some wonderful stories about how marriage equality came to be. Now, the benefits of marriage include everything from being able to obtain health insurance from your spouse's employer to being prevented from having to testify against each other in court. That's one of my favorite benefits as a married person. But I'd like to talk about a few benefits that specifically affect estate planning. So one is that we can improve intestacy outcomes. We can avoid the inheritance tax. We've already discussed that a little bit. Avoid estate taxes. There's a way to protect real estate that's available only to married couples. And then you can also receive preferential treatment for 401ks, IRAs, and other retirement accounts. So dying without a will is called dying intestate. And there are rules of intestacy that determine where a person's assets go in that circumstance. I was explaining this to a client of mine, and she said, intestacy sounds bad, like a medical condition. Well, it's not a medical condition, it's a legal condition, but it's still something we probably want to avoid. So here's how this works. If you are unmarried and die without a will, your estate would go to your children if you have children. If not, it would go to your parents. If you have no living parents, then it would go to your siblings, then your aunts and uncles, and so on. If you are married with no living children, everything goes to your spouse. If you're married with minor children, half of your estate goes to your spouse and half goes to your children. If you are married with adult children and they are the children of both spouses, so there are no children from prior relationships, then the entire estate goes to the surviving spouse. But this is interesting where if you're married with adult children who were children of the spouse who died, but they are not also children of the surviving spouse, so the spouse who died had children from a prior relationship, in other words, the first $100,000 of the estate goes to the surviving spouse plus half of what's left, and the rest goes to the children. And the reason here is that when the surviving spouse dies, we're not expecting that person necessarily to provide for a child that existed before he married, he or she married his spouse. Okay, now it's worth asking, who is a child? In an LGBTQ context, as I said, this question comes up quite a bit. So a child is someone you gave birth to or is in gestation at the time of someone's death. If you and your spouse are if you are married or if you're registered as domestic partners and you give birth to a child during the relationship or the partnership, then that is considered to be your legal child. And then if you legally adopt a child, that's your child. That all seems pretty sensible, but a foster child or a stepchild is not legally a child, which means if we're looking at the rules of intestacy where someone has died without a will, then a foster child or a stepchild would be excluded from inheriting anything. If you care for a child but never adopted the child, or if you had a child and placed the child for adoption with another family, that child would also not inherit from you if you died without a will. So people who come to me seeking estate planning are on their way to avoiding intestacy, but wills can be lost, wills can be challenged, and so having a marriage license or a domestic partner registry can be extremely important. Okay, now we talked about this inheritance tax in Maryland, this 10% tax that applies if you leave something to someone who's not a spouse or a domestic partner or a close relative. If this tax does apply, it can be very hard to pay. There are people who've had to take out a second mortgage on their house or tap into their retirement savings just to pay the inheritance tax. But if you're married, this tax goes away. And if you are married to someone who had prior children, those children become your stepchildren, and the tax doesn't apply to anything you leave to them as well. So this is another benefit of marriage. And while we're on the topic of taxes, there's also an estate tax that can apply depending on how large your estate is. So there's a Maryland estate tax and there's a federal estate tax. In Maryland, there's a tax of up to 16% that applies to any portion of your estate that exceeds $5 million in value. And at the federal level, the exemption is $13.61 million in value, but the tax is 40% for anything that exceeds that amount. So it can be a very punishing tax for those who are in that at that asset level. Married couples avoid these taxes simply by virtue of being married, because anything you leave to your spouse is tax-free. There's an unlimited marital deduction. And then there's also something called portability, which allows you and your spouse to share your exemptions. So at the state level, for example, you would collectively have a $10 million exemption. So for people who are higher net worth individuals, being married can be very helpful. Now, it's possible to do some tax planning if it sounds like these, let's see here, the numbers there. If simple portability is not going to do the job for you, so it's possible to set up a trust under your will that can help avoid taxes, but this is something that only works if you are a married couple. And then I'd like to point out that registering as domestic partners will not help when it comes to estate taxes. So that's really something that you'll only get out of being married. And then I mentioned protecting real estate. So this is one of my favorite benefits of marriage. There's a form of ownership for real estate called tenants by the entirety. And this protects the house that a married couple owns from a creditor coming after either spouse separately. Many same-sex couples owned their house for a long time, in some cases, before they got married. And so they should consider having a new deed prepared that would upgrade their form of ownership to tenants by the entirety. This is not available in all states, but it is available in Maryland. Now, if the creditor is the IRS, all bets are off, or if it's a joint creditor coming after both spouses together. In some cases, this can be very helpful as kind of a free form of insurance. Okay, and then retirement accounts. So another benefit of marriage is that there are more options when it comes to inheriting a retirement account from a spouse versus a partner. So you can leave the money in the deceased spouse's account, you can transfer the funds into an inherited IRA, you can roll the funds over into the surviving spouse's own IRA, which is called a spousal IRA, and treat those assets if they were the spouse's own assets. So using a spousal IRA is one option that nobody except a surviving spouse can use. Under the Secure Act, which passed back in 2019, non-spouses generally have to withdraw the funds from an inherited retirement account within 10 years and pay income taxes on that money when it comes out. So if you receive a retirement account from a spouse versus a friend, you'll be better off from a tax standpoint. Now, I would just like to point out that there are a few caveats to be aware of when it comes to marriage. And one is that your income taxes may increase. So for couples who are high earners in the six-figure range and have about the same salary, It's possible that their annual income tax bill will be a little higher by virtue of their having gotten married. And it's interesting, I've worked with couples who said, well, we don't care. We want the right to get married. We worked hard for it. And so we'll get married anyway and we'll pay this higher tax bill. But you should talk to your accountant to see whether your taxes are likely to go up or not. Estate planning is still important. So even with a marriage license, it's important to have a will, a power of attorney, and advance directive because a marriage license doesn't do the complete job. So it's still important. And one thing that same-sex couples never imagine themselves talking about is prenuptial agreements. So if you're thinking about getting married, it's not a bad idea to at least talk to an attorney about drawing up a prenup so that if the marriage doesn't go the distance, you have kind of a blueprint for what ending the relationship would look like from a financial standpoint. So we're just about, no, we have about 5 minutes left. So let me just briefly mention charitable giving. The LGBTQ community is, I think, uniquely disposed to philanthropy. There's this absence of children we talked about, which can mean there's more in the way of assets and there are no obvious beneficiaries. So this can be a great opportunity to benefit charitable causes that they support, whether it's alma maters, houses of worship, political causes, LGBTQ organizations. I've always said that you should like your estate plan. It should reflect your values and it should remember the people and perhaps the organizations that you believe in and that you care about. So most people don't receive an estate tax break when they make a charitable bequest because those exemptions are so high, as we just talked about. So one helpful strategy, if you do have charitable bequests under your will, is to authorize the person you've named under your power of attorney to make those bequests as gifts if you appear to be at the end of your life, and then you'll receive an income tax break in that final year of your life, and the bequests will be satisfied and they won't be made again under your will. So that's just a brief bit there on charitable giving. So I appreciate your attention with all the technical difficulties and whatnot. And in the time we have left, I would be happy to answer any questions.
Wow, that was an amazing presentation, Lee. And I have to tell you, I've been to a lot of DEI, LGBTQ trainings, and your explanations were the very best. And I feel so much more equipped to understand what the various terms can mean. And I thank you for that. And I certainly learned a lot about the estate planning piece as well. We do have a couple of questions. Let's see, there's one that was in the chat to the panelists. I'll read that for the person who put it in there. It's will quote unquote disabled children override a married surviving spouse in intestacy? So I believe that's if the person is married, doesn't have a will or an estate plan, and has disabled children, will they be preferred if it goes to be dealt with by the courts?
No, I think a child's disability is not a factor in determining where assets go in intestacy. Now, if someone has a disabled child, I mean, that's all the more reason to have an estate plan because they could be on government benefits of some kind, some sort of public assistance. And if they receive an inheritance, they could be disqualified from continuing that assistance. So we can set up a special needs trust. So there's a trustee who will make distributions in a way that doesn't jeopardize the government assistance. So if ever there were an indication to have a will, that would certainly be it.
Well, that's great advice. Does Maryland's inheritance tax apply when the recipient, other than a spouse, was named as the beneficiary of a traditional IRA or Roth IRA?
Yes, it does. So not for life insurance, but it does for retirement accounts. And I
So
had a case where someone.
there's federal tax and the inheritance tax on IRAs.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
I had a case where someone received an annuity, and I think it was $100,000 that paid out $10,000 over 10 years. And they had to pay a 10% inheritance tax on that annuity. So they had to come up with $10,000 right off the bat, even though the money paid out over time. So as I said, we call it the notorious inheritance tax. And it's important.
Yuck.
It's how the Register of Wills keeps the lights on. So it does some good, but it can be difficult, and especially for LGBTQ folks.
Wow. Yeah. They want their money, don't they?
Well,
Could you
absolutely.
please explain tenants by the entirety again? My spouse bought our house before we were legally able to marry. Should we change the house title?
Yes, absolutely. So tenants by the entirety, as I said, is a free form of insurance. And what you would be now, your spouse, if your spouse bought the house and he or she's adding you, then they're really giving you half a house from a legal standpoint. But once the house is titled as tenants by the entirety, it would protect it from a creditor coming after either one of you separately. So a creditor couldn't put a lien on the house if it's titled T by E. And the reason for this is if dad has a gambling problem, we don't want to put mom and junior out on the street. So it protects the family home. I had a couple who had just gotten married. One of them was a lawyer. And I said, now that you're married, you can retitle your house as tenants by the entirety. And she said, oh, that's the whole reason I got married. So romance is not dead, especially among members of the legal profession.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's see. There was just a comment about the need to be sensitive to members of the transgender community. I'll let people check that out because it's kind of long in the Q&A if you want to take a quick look at that. Someone threw in the chat, are you accepting new clients?
Oh, absolutely. I'm just
Okay.
looking at this comment about. Okay, yeah, I'll look at that comment about transgender folks. I'll
Yeah.
just say sensitivity with members of the trans community is very important, and it can feel like you're, walking through a minefield because people aren't sure what to say. And so, part of the reason for that early part of the talk was to give people some guidance on what they should and shouldn't say. And as I said, members of the trans community are used to people getting it wrong. So your best intentions and apologizing if necessary will usually do you stand you in good stead.
Great. Someone wants to know if you're licensed in DC.
No, I'm not. Now, I do help people in DC. I can't go to DC, and I have members of my firm who are DC attorneys. So we can help folks in DC without a problem.
Great. And I know we've had a number of folks ask about the slides and the recording. We will be sending the links to all the recordings out later today with the survey. So please watch for that email. And we are actually at 101, so I'm sorry
Okay.
to have to cut this, but we want to honor our time commitment to everyone. And thank you so much, Lee. This was really great. And I
Well, thank you for having me.
hope everyone has a wonderful afternoon and feels more empowered and equipped and confident to go out and please make those plans. Be
Absolutely.
well and don't forget to vote. Take care.
All right. Take care.
Bye.